Hey everybody, this is Dan.
And this is Ron.
And we're back from our,
hiatus.
Huh? Yeah, I was going to say our European vacation, but only one of us took a European vacation.
That's true. And the one who took a European vacation doesn't like to talk that much about his travel, so...
Right.
He's glad to. I'm sure he's glad to, but doesn't publicize him that much or that often.
Right, and I took a slightly different voyage into...
Insanity.
Seasonal illness.
Oh, okay, that too.
Anyway, so we're doing a shorter, a quick hot take, I guess we'll call it, clickbait. What do the kids call it now?
Yeah, this is totally self-promotional clickbait. So.
Yeah, but I mean, we have strong feelings about the subject, right. But anyway, so Martin Scorsese.
Well, you have strong feelings about it. I have feelings.
Okay.
Or thoughts.
Right. So I guess I'll summarize it because we have not done a great job of summarizing what the hell it is we're talking about most of the time, and that has been a theme of my life. But anyway, so Martin Scorsese, some of you might have heard of him. For those who haven't, he made a couple crime movies in the 70s.
For those of you who haven't heard of him.
Yeah, he knows a lot of famous people anyway. So he publishes, first he gets quoted in Empire magazine as saying Marvel movies are not cinema.
Right.
And then this created a lot of backlash because Marvel basically relies on a very, like Marvel, it's a little bit like Donald Trump. Like there's an unorganized set of like rabid ground troops that they can sick on people that give like, well, they don't say, I mean, I don't think the movie industry actually consciously wanted to make this happen, but you got a lot of very angry superhero fans that will like flood Rotten Tomatoes or IMDb or something when a new movie comes out. They'll like threaten and harass people that give it less than 10 stars or something.
And this isn't to say anything negative on fandom as a whole, and so much relies on fandom. And I won't deny that I'm fans of, you know, I'm a fan of, I want to say if that kind of capital fan, but a fan of certain things and people. But it's that particular. Extreme attitude.
Yeah, and I think like anyway, so I guess to go back to the synopsis before I get distracted.
Right.
So Martin Scorsese, I don't know if he offered it to the New York Times or if the New York Times reached out to him, but somehow an op-ed shows up, and I just read it half an hour ago, and Martin Scorsese basically lays out that he's not trying to thumb his nose at everybody and say, like, your superhero movies suck, but he's saying that the increasing reliance of the overall film industry on a couple very expensive tentpole movies every year for their, essentially their continued existence. There doesn't seem to be a whole lot of other, like, large-scale commercial film activity going on outside these attempts to create these franchises and shared universes, read cross-promotion. And he says that when he was younger and he was getting into movies and throughout a lot of his career, his definition of cinema as opposed to other kinds of moving pictures, I guess, was that he was going to see something that was unexpected, and that these films had become so they were kind of designed from the start to be formulaic enough where you can pretty much, if you've seen one of them, it's like watching Godzilla movies. Like, you know, somebody's going to destroy Tokyo. You know, there's going to be a guy in a big rubber suit.
Right.
And you're watching for, like, fine details, I guess, and slight variations on that formula.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought it was a well-written op-ed. Ron told me to read it. And, Ron... I take Ron's recommendations. So
wow, oh, that's high praise indeed. I mostly take Dan's analyses. Because mine tend to be more of the, yeah, I liked it, it was good, or I didn't like it, it wasn't good, which aren't necessarily the same thing. It could be I didn't like it, even though I recognize it was good. So, anyways, sorry.
That's like, but anyway, so I thought we should talk about this a little bit, because I think it touches on a lot of the things we've talked about over the course of this podcast. It's certainly a thing that, in my experiences making and like half-heartedly trying to distribute independent films, I've run into, and I had some thoughts about what Scorsese had to say. By and large, I agree with his analysis. I think that the larger film industry, I've grown each year since I left college, maybe even a little before I left college, I've just grown less and less interested with the kinds of films that you're going to be able to see on a big screen in a theater, you know, the traditional habitat of movies. And I think a lot of that does come down to the fact that, A, they're not being made for people like me. I know that. You know, they make things for people like me, and they're called space shooter video games. But
they're made for people like me. as we're recording this, we're staring at my computer screen.
With Loki.
The background is Tom Hiddleston as Loki from Thor Ragnarok, throwing up and flipping his twin blue-bladed daggers. But anyways, sorry to cut you off.
No. I think it goes a long way towards pointing out that film has become simultaneously, like, the actual commercial cinema is in decline. I was telling this to Ron earlier, if one of these giant tentpole Marvel movies just were to completely flop, I think there would be a decent number of movie theaters that would outright just go out of business. Certainly the production studios, like, they have bet the farm on this stuff, and if it doesn't continue to produce profit at this incredibly inflated, not very realistic over a long period of time rate, they don't seem to have a plan B. And I think that, like, you could end up with a movie crash. Like, you could have a lot of the big players, maybe not so much now that they've, like, consolidated into these multi-conglomerates, because they have other divisions of the business that could carry a large loss. But even then, like, a large conglomerate, they lose a ton of money on a movie, they're not necessarily going to keep putting that kind of money and effort into movies, into supporting theaters and the distribution chain. Into anything besides internet streaming.
Okay, now I was wondering why you're saying that a spectacular failure would result in the theaters closing as opposed to the production company folding or something like that. But
yeah, because right now it's kind of like, it's like buying a very expensive Picasso, because you know that by buying it, the market's going to go up and you're going to get your money back plus some equity, kind of like buying a house. If that stops being the case, and they have no idea what to do, it could be a good thing. It could be kind of like every good, like in the history of TV in the last 30 years, like TV has gotten substantially better and just kind of keeps getting, I think it's about to peak and kind of top off now, but
we're in the new golden age of television. I did not make that up.
Oh no. Yeah. But it kind of starts with, I mean, I would put the start at the beginning of the 90s. Most people put it around 1999, 2000, when The Sopranos comes out and HBO sets up the prestige format. But that comes down to the fact that, A, TV has this huge Second City complex at the time with the cinema, right? Because everybody thought TV was basically garbage. Like, they had a show that they liked and they defend, but by and large, nobody was going to make a huge deal if you said, like, oh, the TV's probably going to rot your brain. Like, most people are like, you know, it's not science, but it's close enough, right? And that led to a lot of people just trying to prove them wrong. People that were in the TV industry and felt like, oh, this is an affront to all this work I'm doing. And then also you have these small players that want to take a larger market share and are willing to take a financial hit on these big prestige, pretty complicated, intelligent television shows to distinguish a brand. Like, I don't know if HBO ever made made the money back that they spent on Sopranos, because they spent, I mean, like, in terms of brand, as a branding exercise, yes, they made all the money back and then some. Mm-hmm. Same way, like, AMC was losing money on every episode of Mad Men. But,
really?
Oh my God, that show was so expensive to produce. Okay. Yeah, it was, but it sets up the brand. You know, it's kind of like a video game company selling the consoles at a loss to establish, like, oh, okay, this is the console everybody has, and then they make the money on software stuff that comes out afterwards.
So you're saying in this case, AMC is the brand.
Yeah, AMC, because, like...
And then more people watch AMC.
Yeah, because before Mad Men, like, AMC was just kind of, like, the crappier version of Turner Classic Movies, right? Like, it was just a lot of 70s movies that you didn't really... Like, every once in a while, they'd show The Godfather or something.
Well, AMC came first, I think.
Oh, they actually came before Turner Classic Movies?
Yeah, but Turner had Turner.
Right, he had the giant library. He didn't have to show ads. And so, yeah, Turner Classic, it was just always a better experience than AMC for me personally, at least when I was flipping through the television. But yeah, so they all want to prove themselves. That's why all those great Netflix shows came out first, because Netflix was like, crap, all these cable companies are going to take away these streaming licenses we have. We're going to be left with nothing unless we produce an ungodly amount of TV content in like 5 years. And so they would just green light anything. They would try to revive any series that any other network let go of, because they figured they could poach the audience from said network. You know, so like that's why we got more Arrested Development. That's why they captured and killed the Degrassi. That's why, I mean, there's more. Oh, God, there was an AMC show that was The Killing, I think it was, where it was like one season away from finishing. And then they just bought it outright from AMC. Although they Netflix and AMC have like a weirdly like convoluted relationship, because a lot of what made either one of them major players now was directly intertwined, right? Like people only figured out about Breaking Bad when it got to Netflix, because they could stream it constantly, because like I don't remember hearing anything about Breaking Bad for the first 2 years it was on.
I don't remember. I actually never got into it. I know I'm the only person that I know, not that everyone in the world, but I'm the only person that I know that didn't get into Breaking Bad.
I got really into it at the time. Now that I'm watching Sopranos all the way through, I can kind of see that, like, they stole so much from the Sopranos on really? That show. Oh, my God, yeah. They are clearly different shows, and I think the fact that one of them ends right when the housing crash happens and the other one starts right after the housing crash happened, creates a lot of the major tonal differences. That's another whole story. So anyway, so to get back to Marty and Marvel and their ideological disputes. Yeah, I don't see anything that good happening to feature-length film in the next 10 years, just because it's very expensive to make a feature-length film. I mean, it's a lot cheaper than it used to be, but if you want it to have, like, professional-ish production values, you still got to find somebody who's going to cough up at least, like, $100,000 to $500,000. And I think TV also, it's moving toward a niche market. Like, the Marvel movies, to me, it's the last cry of this long tendency of the cinema away from dialogue because of international markets. Like, most U.S. produced films in the last 30 years, over time, there's less and less dialogue. More has to be about large visual spectacles, because if you got a bunch of English language dialogue and subtitles, you can't sell it in China. You can't sell it in Europe.
Well, and actually you can't sell it in China for two reasons. For that, but also you've got to make sure that it abides by Chinese censorship rules.
Right.
But that's,
whereas like US, like TV can be substantially more localized, and you can have an emphasis on writing versus this sort of operatic spectacle. Which that may change too, because it looks like the big players in TV, they're settling, they don't have anything to prove, and they can just keep like milking these various, like, you know, Disney owns all the Fox properties now. They own Star Wars. They own pretty much anything that isn't owned by NBC or Netflix, I think, at this point, right?
And Disney is taking the Fox, what do you call it?
All their film prints in the archive, they've taken them out of circulation because they just don't want to pay for it. And that if you have a large company like that and they're selling the same product from 18 different angles because they're actually this like weird composite corpse of a bunch of other companies they ate up, at a certain point, providing a good service to the public, to the money people, just looks like cannibalizing their own product. So,
right.
And as soon as Disney, as soon as Disney did this, they're just like, all right, we're putting all the Fox films in the vault. So that's like thousands upon thousands of films. A lot of them are extremely, like a lot of the major noir movies were owned by Fox. A lot of the major, like post-1930s musicals, like it, pretty much anything that wasn't owned by Warner Brothers at that point was owned by Fox or Universal.
And there's a lot of smaller theaters, and even some multiplexes that'll show older films.
And that's a huge part of their revenue stream too, because they pay less for those legacy prints.
Right.
And they put away everything except Rocky Horror because they knew that that would actually create armed insurrection. Right. People.
And Rocky Horror is actually still in its first run.
It's right, never ended.
It never ended. It never left the theaters. It's been playing. I mean, you know, it plays once a week at midnight, but all across the country. It doesn't play during the day on multiple screens.
Until Ron's Supreme Proletarian Dictator, that is.
Then I'm going to take it out of general distribution, and I'm going to have it only played at my house. No, I'd never do that. I only watched it once on TV, twice on TV. The first time was before it was distributed for TV, and it was VHS at the time. I had a like fourth generation with Japanese subtitles.
Whoa!
Yeah.
That's some OG shit right there.
Yeah. Now you can get it on streaming.
Mm.
And I know and lots of people have only seen it on TV. I've only seen it on TV, which also means without a shadow cast. But that's neither here nor there. Sorry.
Podcast. How do you feel about Martin Scorsese's feelings about the Marvel movie? Movies.
Everyone say hi to Elizabeth, the pod guest.
Hi, guys. I feel that I'm not educated enough on the subject to make any substantive contribution.
Well, that was a letdown. All right, well.
But I
guess that's my fault for putting you on the spot.
Cheese and wine.
Hey, I'm into that. Cheese and wine.
Oh, say, by the way, Elizabeth and Dan, didn't you see it on TV before we went
Rocky
to see it
Horror?
The
yeah. The first time I ever saw Rocky Horror, I was...
Yeah.
I was 10 years old.
That's too young.
My friend Rory came over for a sleepover, and my dad was like, my dad would do this all the time when I was younger, but he was like, I vaguely remember this being fun in college. You know, you seem pretty precocious. You're ready for an R-rated movie. And it was the first R-rated movie I ever saw.
Wow.
And I had no idea what the hell was going on. I was like, this is just kind of, you know, because I don't know subtext, context, anything. I know that like Susan Sarandon, I don't know if I had the word for it at that point, but I was attracted,
Well, I was, I remember being surprised because y'all had seen it, and then I didn't realize at first that meant you saw it on TV, or you saw it on a small screen.
Right.
Like, that's not Rocky Horror. I watched it on that one videotape, and then I watched it over the last few years because you can actually, like I said, you can get it streaming, right. And I watched it there, and what it does is it underscores that it's not a very good film. you have to watch it with audience participation, and preferably with a shadow cast.
It makes a world of difference because Ron did it for, I don't know how many times Ron's done it, but I did it for the first time a couple months ago with Ron and the podcast and some other cool people. And
I think it was 9 of us that went.
And I had a great time. Yeah. That was an experience.
So anyways, Martin Scorsese.
Martin Scorsese. So
Films in the Vault.
And I think that does underscore one of the things things that Scorsese didn't even point out in the article, which is when the actual market for, and I think they're cannibalizing their market for the future, because if you have a whole generation of people that grow up thinking movies are superheroes, it's going to be really hard to diversify that.
Right.
And I think it's, in the long run, it's going to hurt the conception of cinema. Because, like, even the last couple of years, the Oscar nominees, like, it's been a lot of kind of Marvel-style tokenism. Like, Shape of Water is a movie about, is she going to fuck the fish man? Is the fish man technically a racial minority, right? Or something like, and I feel like there's a lot of stuff where people just, it's comforting people because the rest of the world is going insane and the politics are so toxic, but at the same time, it doesn't allow for a lot of nuance because nobody trusts nuance, I think, at this point. Like, nobody, and there's reasons not to trust nuance, right? Because you've had like 40 years of these kind of, like, I'm an angry, violent, middle-aged white man. I'm supposed to be like a moral cautionary example. So Walter White, Tony Soprano, et cetera, et cetera. And the audience comes away from it thinking, like, I'm kind of depressed. This guy goes out and does shit every day. I like that. You know, they see it as kind of like weirdly invigorating or like validating.
Uh-huh.
So it's a complicated issue, but it's just not. If you don't allow that area for nuanced subtexts, complicated takes on things, then you just end up with a lot of stuff where it's kind of either reasserting what you were already thinking or just sort of blatantly representing these very crude, melodramatic in like the English major sense of like there's a set arc. The point of the narrative is to establish a portrait of metaphysical ideas of good and evil, et cetera, et cetera. But you have these broad archetypes drawn out over and over and over again without much to really chew on if you think about it for that long, or at least that's been my experience going to the movies for the last couple of years.
Do you think we'll have something like the indie revolution that we had in the in the early 90s? When they were still indie, and then they became more, well, now we had some smaller production and distribution companies that provided more money for these smaller films, which eventually became these big, you know, became big studios that got bought up and all that. So eventually, they became part of the mainstream industry. But do you think we'll have something like that?
I really hope we do. I don't know. On it, like, my kind of dark fear is that, you know, now you're going to have maybe four streaming services when the dust clears at the end. There's going to be whatever Disney puts out. If Netflix manages to survive, and then, you know, some kind of combination or something that looks like what Hulu is now, possibly called Hulu.
Uh-huh.
Oh, and then Amazon
Prime. Yeah.
You're still dealing with four though. You're not dealing with really any more companies, platforms than you would have with like video game consoles.
Uh-huh.
So I think it's going to turn into a very video game-like distribution and production model. You're going to have, Netflix is going to be sort of like, Netflix seems to be taking, it's not a perfect metaphor, Netflix seems to be closer to Nintendo than the other guy. The other guys seem a bit more like Microsoft and, what's the other, Sony. I mean, I think Sony actually is part of some of those. And I think you're going to end up with, like, little pockets of independent distribution, but they're not going to be independent. It's going to be more like a third-party support for a video game system. In terms of how it gets bought up. And, like, people are not necessarily going to want to even start production on this kind of stuff, because a lot of it is fairly expensive to produce.
Right.
Unless there's some kind of guarantee that they're going to get onto this platform, right? Like, nobody just starts coding a Nintendo game unless they have some idea that Nintendo's going to let them release something.
Right. Star Wars pulled back. If I recall correctly, Star Wars pulled back on, well, Disney, right?
Disney, yeah. Star Wars, the Empire.
The Empire. The mouse, the Imperial mouse pulled back on some of its plans for Star Wars after Solo wasn't a blockbuster success. Mm-hmm. They actually...
Well, I think after everybody realized it wasn't a movie about beer pong, they were like, stop wasting time and money.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, Solo, instead of killing box office records or something like that, the worldwide gross was more than the budget of the film, mm-hmm. but domestic U.S. Gross was lower. It lost money, mm-hmm. So they, you know, got to rethink everything. There's no guarantee. Mm-hmm. So by the way, have you watched any of the Marvel movies or Star Wars?
I have not. I watched 20 minutes of Force Awakens, and then I felt compelled to do laundry, which was not a good sign because I can literally be sitting around like playing with my belly button, and the last thing I think about is laundry. There was like something that looked like an orange soccer ball. There was like somebody who was supposed to be sort of like Darth Vader, clearly just kind of speaking the screenwriter's own anxieties about remaking. It's a movie about the anxiety of remaking Star Wars and like all the characters. And in the 20 minutes, great, I did not watch. It's like, what, 5 hours long or something? Like, yeah, like Darth Vader's like, am I going to stack up to the old guy even if I don't have asthma?
Yeah, Kylo Ren, by the way, is his name.
And I was just sort of like, okay, this is...
It even begins with a desert planet.
I mean, I think eventually a lot of these movies, maybe this is already happening, but as more and more of day-to-day life becomes people watching screens, produced images and stuff, uh-huh. the only way to make content relatable is to just sort of like almost talk about TV the same way that, say, like 18th century literature talked about walking in the woods or something, because that's the language people know. That's the thing they're encountering every day.
So I've seen all the Star Wars films, and I've seen almost all the Marvel movies. I think I might not have seen Thor 2.
Okay.
And it was kind of... In fact, I'm not sure if I saw Thor 1.
Thor 1 in the theater.
Oh, you did? You did? Okay.
I had a matinee with my friend Andy. Yeah. Anyway, it's not good.
You saw...
Yeah, I saw the first Thor. That was not a good movie. Uh-huh. I mean, when I was a teenager, like the very for the Bryan Singer X-Men and the Sam Raimi Spider-Man stuff was coming out.
Yeah, yeah.
I saw, you know, I went to X-Men the day that it came out because I was like, finally, you know, all this, like, up to that point, you know, I was a weirdo for hoarding these comic. I mean, I still am a weirdo for hoarding the comic books, but the culture's more willing to enable me. But yeah, I was excited about it, and I was like, okay, why are they all in leather, and why does everything just kind of look like drab and dark?
Right, in the comics, it's spandex, not leather.
Right, everything's just bright colors, and granted, that was money issues, but, you know, I liked the Spider-Man movies when I saw them. They hit, and I'm sure if I saw a lot of these movies, and I wasn't a, like, jaded, bitter 30-year-old man, I'd probably enjoy them, which I guess is what, you know, Martin Scorsese is just kind of saying, if I wasn't a jaded, bitter 80-year-old man, uh-huh. I would probably enjoy these things. But
well, he says if they came out when he was of a certain age, he would have been going to them.
Yeah.
So he made it. He was
I mean, the first date I ever went on was to this the second X-Men movie. You know, it becomes, and I think a lot of the relationship to the cinema now, it's almost like a place more than, like, I think a lot of people now, they think of, or a lot of like Gen Z kids probably just remember like Marvel movies is like, oh, that was the thing I did with my friends at this point in time, and it has this emotional significance, and that transcends like a critical perspectives.
Uh-huh. Go ahead. Oh, I was going to say the bit about I think when Martin Scorsese said, I can't remember if it was in this article or if it was in the first quotes or in both, about the movies being like theme parks, or at least he was explaining it more in the article. Yeah, they are like theme parks. And so I see them all, and I go see them, even the ones that I hear aren't that good. I'll go see them because they're comic book movies and because it's a Star Wars movie and because they're comfortable.
Right, it's like if you met your husband or wife at a shitty bar, you're not thinking like, man, that bar was shitty, you know. You think like, oh, you know, pleasant memory of something nice happening. Like, you think of it in the context of your life as opposed to the context of the cinema, and that's dangerous to the cinema, because the cinema does need to kind of exist as a place elsewhere for it to have the space to do the kind of exciting things that got me, at least got me into, I presume, what probably got Martin Scorsese into the movies, of just sort of going into this room with no clear idea what I was going to see, and just sort of having this experience I was not expecting to have that was nonetheless like deep and profound.
Right. But that's part of the things that is cinema being something that has stuff that you don't expect.
Right.
Whereas you go to a theme park, you know, okay, I'm going to go on a roller coaster. It's going to go up. It's going to go down. It's going to go up. It's going to go down. There's going to be some loop-de-loops and all that. And you get told beforehand, okay, this is the best and the newest roller coaster because it's got these particular loop-de-loops, or you're going to go sideways, or it's going to have the biggest drop of any roller coaster ever. And so actually, I'll watch the Star Wars movies. I don't know how many times I've seen The Force Awakens, but in part, it's not because it's a great movie, but because if I'm sitting there and I'm having kind of like a blah day, and it's like, I really need something comforting right now, I know I'll watch The Force Awakens again. Mm. Not because it's my favorite movie. I actually have a hard time sometimes watching my favorite movie over and over again, because I also don't want to ruin them. And sometimes because I don't, you know, I know I won't have that element of surprise that I'm looking for in a quote-unquote good movie. But I'll watch this. I don't know how many times I've seen, say, Lawrence of Arabia and 2001: A Space Odyssey.
Oh, yeah, I do the same thing with like old episodes of Daria. Mm-hmm. Like, I can just throw that on. I know it front to back. I can walk. I can do dishes. I can do whatever. But it's like having a fireplace on in the house, basically, more than watching something specifically. And yeah, I totally know that feeling.
Yeah.
And I think that's a deeper, I mean, if we're getting into like neuroscience, that's probably a more all-encompassing connection, like mental emotional connection, than seeing something and thinking that was good. And that's probably why the companies, they want to engender that relationship to the material. I mean, I guess a lot of this goes back, like Star Wars was the first, at least the first I can think of, franchise where that was really the idea of it as this cultural phenomena more than even as a movie, allowed for this huge amount of merchandising, this fan culture, this sort of like an entire subculture that's like probably larger than some like gender identifications at this point, around. So I think like, you know, hardcore Star Wars and Star Trek, I guess, maybe, but the Star Wars, it was the one out of the gate, and suddenly they're all like, oh, we can make a ton of money if we create, and like my older sister, my brother-in-law, the Gen X people that I know, if I bring up something about Star Wars, or just like, because I mean, I don't particularly care for any of the Star Wars movies at this point, it's sort of like you're criticizing ice cream or something. They're like, why can't you let this thing make me happy? Why don't you want me to be happy? As opposed to, oh, okay, I don't agree with your idea that like the cantina scene is kind of racist, or like the...
Well, I think that the closer that somebody is to, or the closer that like a book or movie or comic book is to like somebody's sort of like, well, both like the country like national mythology, but also like people's sort of internal mythologies about like themselves and the society around them, like the closer that like cultural item is to them, like the less able they are to like criticize it or to look at it with a critical eye.
Right. I mean, it's probably how I feel about something like fast food. I think that's the only thing where, and like, I intellectually I understand that every company producing fast food is pretty much horrific. I can't think of an exception in that regard. You know, their practices, their overall ideology. But, you know, you're sucking at that McDonald's French fry teat from a young enough age, and you're going to call it mom, right? Like,
you're not going to call it mom. That's the most disturbing thing I've
ever heard. You know, like, I still...
You killed wrong.
Like, if I go into a McDonald's, I eat that, I have, like, it's almost like they're manufacturing a Proustian moment, right? That pardon, remembrance of things past. I guess they don't call it that anymore. In Search of Lost Time, that's the proper name now. He eats that cookie, suddenly he's transported back to being a kid, and he remembers all this stuff so vividly. And... I think with, like, fast food, I think with stuff like Star Wars, it's almost like we figured out how to manufacture that effect. You know, and I don't believe in metaphysics, so I believe that, you know, everything going on in your head is a physical phenomena. I mean, you probably could, like, I'm sure at some point they're going to map out, like, okay, this is how we get the Proust effect, and then this is how we get them to buy toys when they're 45 years old or whatever, you know, like, because of this kind of constant reinforcement of, like, this is a sense that the environment around you has not changed and abandoned you, which, especially with the tech stuff, like, I mean, I'm 30 and I feel behind the curve. Like, I talked to somebody who's 20 about their phone. I'm like, oh, that's... Wow, they do that now?
That's how I feel about TikTok. I'm like, I have no idea, like, what... Or, like, I had someone, like, recently, my coworker had to explain to me what a VSCO girl was. That's basically how I feel about all the things that 16-year-olds are doing now.
Uh-huh. I actually just watched my first TikTok for the first time a few days ago with a friend of mine, and we watched a bunch of TikToks.
It's so weird.
Yeah.
It's like, what's happening?
I'm still not sure what a TikTok
is. It's like it exists on a different plane or something. Yeah. That's how I felt.
Is it like a Vine?
It's kind of like that. Yeah.
You could do a little more with it. Having not done it, it looks like you could do a little more, you could do more with the production and the film editing than you could with a Vine. But actually my friend and I watched it. We watched a bunch of TikToks and I call them watching them, not just looked at, but watching them. And this was, right after reading the Martin Scorsese article. And actually we found more surprising stuff and more quote unquote cinematic stuff about these 30-second TikToks than about the Marvel movies. Because, you know, some of it was just garbage. A lot of it was...
Even, like, garbage, if it's interesting... Like, I feel like a lot of the most informative experiences I've had in kind of, like, when I was learning how to read movies, when I was learning how to read TV or moving pictures in general, a lot of it was, like, the really bad stuff, and I just trying to pinpoint, like... A, why does this make me more uncomfortable than things that are technically well-designed that are supposed to make me uncomfortable? Because, like, I can laugh all the way through Poltergeist and did, but, you know, I can watch, like, Santa and the Ice Cream Bunny and find it generally, like, genuinely unnerving. Santa the Ice Cream Bunny's not even supposed to be under. I don't know what it was supposed to, I guess it was just supposed to be cheap because that's how you end up with a guy in a gorilla suit in Santa going through an amusement park in the middle of the summer. But maybe that'll be our Festivus episode, I think. I need to see that again. Santa and the Ice Cream Bunny.
Santa and the Ice Cream Bunny. No, I've never heard of it.
It's one of the worst movies ever made on a technical level. Basically, this guy was given access at the end of the season to this, like, random amusement park in Florida. And he's like, I'm going to make a movie. And kind of like Manos Hands of Fate, right? The guy was a truck driver and somebody bat him. You can't make a movie in 5 days. And then he did. if you can call Manos Hands of Fate a movie, but
hey, it was enough of a movie that it made it onto Mr. Science Theater, right?
Something was many things in that movie were very unexpected, so it definitely passes the Marty test.
For cinema. Look at Plan 9 from Outer Space, which is, you know, been called the worst movie ever made for so much. There's definitely a lot unexpected in there.
Yeah, and it's like more engaging than a traditionally good movie, and I think like bad acting too. You hit this point of like, well, what are my standards of believable human behavior? How did I construct these? And then I start looking at, like, how do people in my life actually talk? A lot of people do not necessarily put the emphases in the right places when they're talking. It's awkward. They talk over each other, this, that, and the other thing. And it looks almost more like bad acting. Like, when I was going through those Degrassi episodes, the 80s ones, the fact that the kids aren't technically that good at acting in the beginning almost makes it more believable that they're teenagers, because they are just sort of parsing out, what is the performance that society expects out of me? And there are those kind of like weird tonal hiccups in there.
Wow, how did we get from Martin Scorsese to Degrassi? That's really impressive.
All roads lead to Degrassi.
Dan. Because Dan. Dan, who has just watched over 5,000 hours of Degrassi?
All of it. I have not seen Kids of Degrassi Street other than that. And I think there's like a Halloween special that was non-canon, but otherwise I've seen every iteation, every episode.
Wow. Wow.
Wowza.
Yeah.
Some of it was very good. Some of it was very bad. But on the whole, it was a nice, wholesome place to spend time. Like, I think a lot of prestige television is about very damaged people who can't trust each other. And certainly that makes for great drama. But it's also like a very paranoid, uncomfortable space to spend like 86 straight hours in.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas Degrassi, it's like wholesome. You know, people have problems. They fix the problems. They reach out to the community. You have like, I guess, a very constructive form of melodrama in the sense that like it was designed as a teaching tool before it was designed as a television program. So the idea is like you show the problem and then you show the kid like, oh, okay, you're not alone. Here's like one way to deal with this thing. And honestly, I think that I can't think of another television show that actually does that and makes good on it. Like there's a lot of old sitcoms where they're like, oh, we found Billy with marijuana. We're going to have a heart to heart and sit down.
And that'll solve it.
Right. Everything gets solved in 30 minutes. That doesn't happen. Older Degrassi, they tended to resolve the stuff quicker because I think they always thought they were going to get canceled at any second. Later stuff, they'll drag out. Like, there's a beautifully written storyline where this girl gets day raped at a party, and then she just kind of deals with the residual trauma of it for a full two seasons.
Oh, wow. Yeah,
and
that's on something.
They got the details, like, so it was, like, believable. We felt like, you know, this was, like, fairly advanced sense of empathy with the behavior and what the person's going through that I don't get from a lot of other television, really.
Yeah, yeah. Where everything is wrapped up at the end of the 22 minutes.
Right, or the person needs to stay fucked up because that's the whole, like, hook.
Yeah.
Right? Like, you can't, like, Tony Soprano can't get over his mother or else the show ends.
Mm-hmm.
Man, so this is turned into almost an hour. It's supposed to be a mini episode.
It's supposed to be 20 minutes. You said 10 minutes. Well, maybe 20 because there's a lot.
All right, so we're going to cut 40 minutes.
Yeah. So Martin Scorsese.
And do you have any final thoughts? Because I've been talking quite a lot.
No.
This is probably the first episode we've recorded where I haven't been stoned for the recording. So this is what you get.
Instead, you're caffeinated.
Oh, that's why it's only 46 minutes now.
It's like on fast forward.
No, if I'm stoned, I can do 46 minutes of just pauses. I'm that good.
There were very few pauses on this. When we go through the editing process, I think there's it's not going to go far below 46. It'll go down to 43.
Mm.
We'll cut out maybe 2 or 3 minutes out of this as opposed to the usual. At least for this length, we would have cut out at least 10, 15 minutes of pauses.
Yeah, yeah.
And ums and errs and stuff.
And would you like some wine?
So I want to give Ryan the closing arguments here, but do you have any final thoughts about Martin Scorsese's feelings about Marvel movies before we move on to the next mini
or
regular
very
big
or
rabbit ear air quotes there.
Yeah. I'm good. I mean, I definitely agree with his take. And this is as someone who watches all these movies and look forward to Star Wars, not The Last Jedi. Wait, Force Awakens, The Last Jedi. What's the next one? I already forget.
But wait, how can it be The Last Jedi if they're making another one?
No, that was
false
The Last
advertising.
Jedi.
It was a class action lawsuit right there.
Yeah. It didn't say The Last Star Wars.
Oh, yeah.
It just said The Last Jedi. The next one is Rise of Skywalker. I already have my tickets. So I bought my tickets while I was overseas.
I'm waiting for them to make like a newly revamped, culturally sensitive Jar Jar Binks movie. I'm going to be waiting a while.
Oh, you know, I will say about Star Wars is that I actually went and started watching, starting from Force Awakens, and I went and saw Force Awakens multiple times in the theater. And it wasn't because of nostalgia for something that I, you know, when the movies first came out when I was a kid, and the nostalgia for that. I actually didn't see them. I didn't see the first two Star Wars, which wasn't called A New Hope the first time it came out, but eventually called that after Empire. The first one I saw was Return of the Jedi, and I still didn't see the other two until several years later. Somebody had to explain to me all the background and the information before I saw Jedi. Or Return of the Jedi, because now Jedi can be two things.
Oh, yeah. So Jedi's still the only one I ever saw in the theater, because I saw when they did that reissue when George Lucas decided to make Boba Fett shoot first or something.
Greedo
shirts for you.
Yeah, Greedo. Great name.
Greedo. I thought it was
Greedo. Greedo, not okay. Greedo. Greedo shot first. Sorry, you made the comment about the racism of the
Star Wars, the Jersey Shore.
Yeah. but it was nostalgia for something that I never experienced.
GTFL, Jim Tan, The Force Laundry.
I don't get it.
Oh, I watched 30 episodes of Jersey Shore.
Oh.
One of the big things that, and again, bad things that have a lot of very interesting random crap going on in them.
Yeah.
But yeah, GTL, Jim Tan Laundry, which is kind of the religious metaphysics of the Jersey Shore, as best as I understood. Oh, DTF, right. Yeah.
I watched all of Jersey Shore. Dirty Shore. I watched all of Dirty Shore.
And that's why we're doing a podcast together now. Somehow the two least likely people to finish all of Jersey Shore
The whole thing.
Have like all met on the internet and are talking at you now.
Right. I'm saying I agree wholeheartedly with what Martin Scorsese was saying, and that's as someone who has seen almost all the Marvel movies, looks forward to them, doesn't think that they're great movies, but goes to watch them anyways, goes to see all the Star Wars movies, doesn't think that they're great cinema per se, but really enjoys them. So
cool. So stay tuned. We're doing kind of a marathon session. We're going to put this up as two episodes, I think, maybe three episodes even, depending on how long it goes.
Well, really unrelated episodes.
Right. Yeah, but we're going to talk about, we went to go see, it's not in wide release at all now, I think, but
not
the
yet.
Jay and Silent Bob reboot. We saw it with Kevin Smith and Jason Mewes in the theaters. Great experience. And hopefully you can join us for that episode, because I know Ron probably has a lot of thought, because Ron has seen more Kevin Smith movies than possibly Kevin Smith has. and I have a lot of thoughts about it too. So until next time.
All right. See y'all. Wait, Elizabeth, don't forget to say bye.
Bye.
Okay. See y'all next time.